Is this screen?
Let me know when you're ready. Turn it off.
Oh, yeah, I'm good.
Should we start?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, welcome, everybody. So we are excited to have our last colloquium speaker of the semester. I'd want to have a double head with the keynote speaker today. That would be awesome to have both of you here today. So happy you could come. So this is Megan Ivory. She got her PhD in physics from the College of William & Mary. She led the quantum information systems teams at team at Cold Quantra in Boulder, was a research associate at the University of Washington in Seattle, and now she's a staff scientist at Sandia National Labs. I'm so sad we didn't overlap. Like, I left right before she came. Bummer. I would have loved to work there while you were there. She currently works a lot on ion atomic clocks and trapped ion quantum computing. She's part of one of those big quantum information science centers from the DOE, the Quantum Systems Accelerator. And not because of maybe a good platform, though, she does a lot of quantum outreach too, and then probably a lot through QSA as well.
Yeah.
I'm guessing. She's generally very passionate about sharing her science with others and trying to find a way to bring it to high schools and other audiences. She's led multiple quantum workforce development programs. One of them is the summer school for students and teachers, the QCAM. And I should talk, stop talking. So I'll let her give her talk and yeah, enjoy. Thank you, Megan.
Thank you all for being here, and for everybody that I've met with. I've had a really great time just meeting various faculty members and students and exploring Flagstaff. You might see me on the trails this weekend. But yeah, I'm at Sandia National Labs, and I'm going to talk about an atomic clock project. But I first want to give you some perspective, because you're probably all aware that there's a lot of quantum stuff going on right now, and it's a pretty exciting time to be in this field. So let's see if this will let me advance. Okay, so there's something that people are calling the quantum revolution 2.0. I think lasers were 1.0.
Yeah, heard that thing still there. Oh, I don't know if you could see it or not.
I could not. Thanks. Got it. All right. So right now there are a lot of applications that are starting to become realized that take advantage of quantum mechanics, and those span a lot of different areas. There's quantum sensing, where the clocks fall in. There's also things like magnetometers, because if you are using an atom, which is a quantum thing, to do sensing, it can be sensitive to magnetic fields, it can be sensitive to gravity. And you can use these kinds of sensors for things like inertial navigation systems, which is pretty cool. There's also loads going on in quantum computing. There's a lot of hype around it, a lot of news around it, which is interesting. So anything spanning quantum annealing to what we have at Sandia is called a noisy intermediate scale quantum system, or a NISC system. There are various algorithms, error correction, characterization, validation, verification, benchmarking, lots of stuff going on there. And then there's also stuff like communication applications, like how can you securely transmit information from one place to another, and how can quantum enable that? And then for all of these applications, there are actually a number of different platforms that you can choose from. So there are things, sorry, I got to move my mouse back over here. Or do I? Let's try this one. Yes. Oh, hey, I had graphics for all those. Computing. We're in the matrix. There we go. All right. Communication. Great. So for our platforms, I'm going to call them quantum systems here. There are things like atomic qubits. That's the world that I play in, where we have single or multiple atoms that you can use as these sensors or computers or communicators. There are superconducting qubits. Oh, right, graphics for these too. You know what atoms look like in cartoon world. Superconducting qubits are a little bit more man-made. So they're actually things that people fabricate, and they're fabricated to have these kinds of quantum properties that we're interested in. And then there's a lot of emerging technology that we've just started to kind of scratch the surface on and understand. So things like photonic qubits, that they're actually a little older and there's a lot been done, but actually realizing the implementation of that, semiconductor quantum dot qubits, nitrogen vacancy diamonds. And along with all these systems, depending on what system you choose, there's gonna be a load of engineering technology that goes along with it. So for the atoms, we're thinking about fabrication technology, vacuum systems, integrated photonics, lasers, and control. For the superconducting qubits, you need dilution refrigerators, microwave electronics, et cetera. And then kind of spanning kind of all these is, you know, you can think about frequency conversion for quantum networking, making everything smaller if you want to actually take it out into a field and be deployable. And for the quantum computing area right now, we're still developing assembly level languages, which I think is pretty neat. So this is stuff that I'm aware of going on at Sandia, which is a lot. And I don't have time, I don't even know about all of it. So I definitely don't have time to talk about it all today. What I am gonna talk about is atomic clocks using trapped ions and talking about a lot of the different technology that we're engineering at Sandia to make this a reality. And then I'm hoping I have just a little bit of time at the end to mention our quantum computing project as well. And before I get into the nitty gritty, I think there should be another column here that points out that to make any of this happen, we need a very multidisciplinary workforce, because to build a quantum computer should no longer be the job of physics PhD students. We also need engineers across the board, fabrication engineers, optical engineers, mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, computer science engineers, in addition to physicists. And then on the applications end of things, we need people like mathematicians and chemists to actually tell us how to use these better. So as far as getting involved in the field, I would say if you're interested, kind of regardless of what STEM discipline you are in, there is a place for you. Okay, so as an outline, I'm first gonna try to get you excited about atomic clocks. How many of you are already really excited about atomic clocks? Oh my God! Are you recording this for credit? Raise your hand. I'm super impressed. I gave this talk a month ago for an engineering department and I got like one hand and I was like, all right, we have work to do. Cool. Well, maybe I just skipped that section, huh? No, I'll get into it just in case. And then because I want you to understand the technology that we are engineering, I think you need to know a little bit about how we actually trap an ion for this stuff. So I'll give you a little tutorial of how to trap an ion, and then you'll all have weekend projects. And then I'll get into the nitty gritty of these four different engineering efforts that we have underway at Sandia. And those are microfabricated surface traps for actually trapping the ions, integrating the waveguides that we'll need to deliver light to the ions, integrating detectors that we need to collect the light, which is our signal from the ions, and then how we can wrap this all up into a really nice compact vacuum package. And then in the last few minutes, I want to talk about QScout, which is our quantum computing project. And you'll already know a lot about QScout because it's based on trapped ions, and you'll know how to trap an ion. Okay, why do we care about atomic clocks? So if you have used GPS to navigate on your phone, you should care about atomic clocks. So in one example, well, first of all, how does GPS work? So we've got satellites up on Earth. The Earth is a sphere. And so if you measure the time it takes for a signal to go between Earth and a satellite, that time will narrow down your position to a circle on the sphere. And so if you do that with three different satellites, you can triangulate your position to one spot. And the reason that we care about atomic clocks and making good atomic clocks is because if your clock that's measuring that timing signal changes by 40 microseconds, like not even something that we would notice in our lifetime, 1.5 seconds in 100 years, that means your distance can be off by 6 miles, which means I would not have made it here. This Flagstaff is bigger. So this is why we're trying to create better and better atomic clocks. You know, this is just an example for navigating here on Earth, but what if we want to go beyond Earth? Like what if we want to go to the moon? Or NASA has deep space projects going on. So you can imagine that if 40 microseconds in a day can lead to a 6-mile difference, you know, you're never going to hit whatever planet you're aiming for out there. So we need better atomic clocks to make that happen. And it would be nice if we could put the clock on whatever is going to space. So right now, a lot of this navigation happens with a ground-based sensor here on Earth. And so you have to send the signal and then receive it back. So it's two-way communication. If you can put the sensor on whatever vehicle is out there, you can cut that time in half. So how do we make this happen? Right now, we have two choices in the atomic clock world. Well, it's a spectrum, but okay, these are the ends of the spectrum. So on the one hand, we have the chip scale atomic clock, CSAC, is what we call it, and it loses a second every 16,000 years or so, and this is the basis for a lot of GPS that's going on right now, and it's really tiny and cute. So it's small, it's okay, but we might want to do better if we want to go farther. On the other side of the spectrum, we have optical atomic clocks. These are the best in the world, and these lose a second every 300 billion years. But it takes up an entire laboratory. So what we're aiming to do at Sandia is kind of get somewhere in the middle of those. So make something bigger than this, smaller than this, and also have the performance somewhere in the middle. Okay, how can you use an atom as a clock? So hopefully this picture looks familiar to folks. You've seen this in like a chemistry class or something. You've got your atom, there's a nucleus with some stuff going on. You've got electrons that go around the outside. And if you excite an electron, it will hop up to another quantized energy level. So that energy difference, your energy is associated with a frequency. And for our atoms, these energy differences are typically addressed with electromagnetic waves. And that can be megahertz, so electronic sources, or up to terahertz using laser sources. The nice thing about atoms is that frequency is the exact same for all of a particular species of atom, which is something you don't get with the man-made stuff. You kind of got to tune them. And they're sensitive to external fields, which is annoying unless you want to make a sensor. So how do you use an atom to make a clock? So all clocks start with an oscillator. In a grandfather clock, you've got the pendulum swinging back and forth. That's an oscillator. And you know, with grandfather clocks and other things, those oscillators are not all going to be perfectly in sync. If you have, you know, a row of 10 grandfather clocks, there will be some difference. Atoms, as I just mentioned, are exactly the same with that frequency. So can we use that frequency difference as an oscillator? Well, frequency is kind of already an oscillator. It's something we use to talk about waves. So with our atoms, we are talking about optical transitions. So transitions that we can address by shooting a laser at it, which means it's oscillating very, 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 very quickly. So you can kind of think of this as the ticking of your clock. If there's more ticking, if its frequency is higher, you can make a more accurate clock because of that, the resolution of those ticks. So this is how the optical clocks are using these optical transitions to do that. So the way that you use that atom is you actually start with the laser. The laser itself is really your oscillator. It's got that wave going up and down. And you shoot that laser, which is imperfect, at an atom. And if you get the frequency right, your atom will go from ground to excited state. And so what you can do is you can take a picture of the output. Is it in the ground or excited state? And then you use that as feedback to make your laser more accurate. That's essentially all an atomic clock is. So what are the goals for this? This is a DARPA TikTok project. We call it TikTok, the Trapped Ion Clock with Technology on Chip. We love our acronym for Sandia. So the goals of TikTok are, as I said, hitting that sweet spot in the middle. So if you want to, you know, if you're familiar with frequency instability, this is the kind of range we're aiming for, 10 to the minus 14 per root tau. And that falls right in the middle of the state of the art at NIST and CSAC. And similarly for volume, we're aiming for a liter, which also falls in the middle of, you know, whatever a giant optics table is, and this the tiny little chip scale thing that you saw. And so we like to draw these little renderings of our final atomic clocks inside of a liter bottle. Okay, hopefully you're all excited about atomic clocks. No, if you weren't already. So now we're gonna learn how to trap an ion. There are 6 steps. That's all you need. That's all it is. I just do 6 things every day. First, you need a source of atoms. Then you need a vacuum system to stick them in. You need some way to confine them. You need to cool them. You need to be able to manipulate the internal state, and you need a way to read out the internal state. Cool? Okay, we're gonna walk through these one at a time, starting with the oven, or our source of atoms. So, little chemistry for us all. We already have our periodic table. I was really excited about that. But so atomic physicists, we like to make things as easy as possible. We don't like to do a lot of complicated math. So what we do for our systems is we try to make anything just 2 levels, a ground state and excited state. If you have a bunch of electrons flying around the place, you've got so much more math to deal with. So what we typically do is like to choose atoms in this column of the periodic table because they have how many valence electrons? 1, exactly. So that's nice. We have 1 electron. We can ignore everything else. It's either going to be ground or excited. So we're going to choose something in the second column. Why would we do that? Because we're making an ion. So the first thing we do, actually this comes a little later. The first thing we do is we take our block of metal or whatever in that second column of the periodic table. We shave off a little piece with a little razor blade, and we shove it in a tiny little tube that's pinched at one end. And we run current through that tube. So it gets really, really hot, vaporizes the block of metal in there, and spews it out into the world. And then as we're spewing out these neutral atoms, we also hit it with a laser that will photoionize that atom. So one of those little electrons goes bye, and we're left with 1 valence electron, so we've got our 2-level system, and we now have a charged ion. Cool. So if we have, and we have to stick this in a vacuum system because, you know, I can't catch an ion in the air because there's lots of other stuff going on in our atmosphere, and it's going to kick it out. It's going to, interact with it. Maybe the ion doesn't live very long because it picks up an electron somewhere else. So we're doing all of this stuff inside of a vacuum system so that the ion is interacting with nothing. And then we need to confine it. We can't just have it floating around in the world. So remember that these are charged. So the way that we confine it is using electric fields. Charged particles will be sensitive to electric fields. So the way I like to think about it is we can put it in a box and we can apply some voltages to 2 sides of those boxes. If we apply positive voltage and we have a positive ion, what's that ion going to do? It's going to try to escape. It does not like the positive voltage. It's repulsed by it. And so maybe it goes like that. And as soon as it's about to, escape this wall or something, we change up the game on it. And then it sees that positive voltage again. It's like, oh, wait, now I want to go back over here. And this happens repeatedly. Fortunately, we do not have a graduate student pushing those buttons. What we do is we apply an RF voltage to those electrodes. So it's switching back and forth, that AC voltage. And so the kind of traps that we make to do this confinement are 4 rod traps or blade traps. And you can think about the electric potential inside of there is something like this, or a classical picture of what's going on is like this flip-flopping trickle thing that's going on. So you can actually make like traps like this by having a Pringle-shaped disc that rotates and stick a ball inside. There are YouTube videos on that. It's fun. There are also YouTube videos of people using this to trap charged dust particles out of high voltage systems in their garage. Let's see if I can play this. I think it has sound. Let's see if the sound comes through. It doesn't. The sound is like this classical sort of thing. But yeah, basically you can make traps by applying an RF voltage to a paperclip in the right way. So you have little charged particles in there. Okay. I had it already set up. So now we can confine our atoms, our ions, but they're still wiggling around. What we want to do is kind of take that energy away from them because we ultimately want to hit them with lasers. And so we don't want them moving around because I don't want to play with my laser pointer like that. So we want to cool them down so they stay in place. And the way that we do that is something called laser or Doppler cooling. So we use a laser to cool our ions, which sounds counterintuitive. I'm used to like burning ants and things with lasers. But here's how laser Doppler cooling works. You have our cartoon picture of the atom, ground in excited state, and there's a resonant frequency that connects those. I like to think about that as the ion's favorite color. So the ion is moving, and if you remember from the Doppler effect, you know, the meow kind of sound as vehicles go by. So if something's approaching you, those waves will get squished. And if something is going away from you, they will kind of get expanded. That's the way I like to think about it. So what the ion sees in this picture is waves like this. It sees, because it's going in this direction, these waves will be squished or more blue, and these ones will be more red. So what we do is we choose a color of our laser that is not exactly that resonance, not that favorite color that the atom likes. We choose it slightly red-detuned or less energetic. And that's because when this happens, because the ion is moving, when it sees that laser coming at it, it doesn't look red. It actually looks more blue. It looks closer to its resonance frequency. And because of that, it's more likely to absorb a photon from it. And when that happens, it will actually also absorb the momentum that comes with that photon. And so because the momentum is in the opposite direction, the overall effect is that it slows down. And this is surprisingly effective. You can take that really, really hot atom that's floating around and you can cool it to less than a mile per hour in a fraction of a second, which is nice. It's nice when things work, right? Okay, and then the last things you need now that you have this cooled atom is a way to manipulate its internal state and read out its internal state. So this is where I have to tell you that I lied to you, and this is not a simple two-level system. There's a little bit more going on here, but don't fret. What we have here, I just want to point out a couple different colors that we're using, basically. So we've got our Doppler cooling transition, and that's 369 nanometers. And we have a repump transition because they don't always fall back down. So sometimes they can go from that excited state over into these states. And then we need to get them back into that cycling transition. So we apply another laser, 935 nanometers. So now we've gone from UV to infrared. And for our clock, we're actually going to use this transition, which is 435 nanometers. I'm only pointing out those colors because we need to think about this later when we're integrating waveguides. We need to make sure that those waveguides actually transmit those colors well. But basically, we can address all of these transitions with lasers. So that's how we're going to actually control the states. I had to put an equation in. So this is the equation that gives us our clock instability. And so we've chosen our clock transition here, this 435 nanometers, because this is what gives us an instability that is comparable to what we need for the program. So we choose a really narrow line width transition in order to make this happen. What all this looks like in a laboratory is something like this. So we have the vacuum chamber is like the big stainless steel box. It's got some windows around there. Let's see if I can point to things for anybody online as I wave my arms around. It's got windows for the laser beams. This is our helical resonator. This is the RF source. So the voltage that's alternating and actually confining the ions. We have our imaging system up here. So what we do is we take a picture of the ion, and if we see fluorescence, we know it's in one state. If we don't see fluorescence, it's in another state. And then all of this stuff around it, these are just ways of manipulating the beams, measuring the amplitudes, and feeding back to stabilize all that stuff. Now, if you were to look inside of one of these windows, maybe this one, you would see the actual trap electrodes. So here are, this is a blade trap. So they're applying RF to maybe this one and the one behind this one. And we're confining it along this axis with these electrodes. And if you look very closely at the end of that yellow arrow, there's a single ion, which I think is cool. You can actually like take photos of a single ion just with a camera with a long exposure time. This is a photo that was taken at the University of Oxford and won some prizes. So I think it's really neat. Okay. All right. So how do we go from this into something that we could fit on a satellite? That's the question. So this is where these four engineering efforts come in. And the first one I'm going to talk about is microfabricated surface traps. So you've seen the picture of the potential that we're trying to produce. And we typically do this with four rods or four blades or something like that. Well, somebody clever decided, what if we rotate this and we can actually produce a similar potential by creating a surface of electrodes. And so that's what we have here. We'll give you a slightly different perspective here. So here we've got our what we call our RF rails or electrodes, and there are DC ones around them. And this produces what we call a pseudo potential, where this dark point in the middle is the minimum. So that's where your ion would sit. So here in this picture, the ion is confined radially from the RF potential. So it's kind of stuck wiggling around those blue arrows, but it's still free to move around the other axis. So up top, it's free to move in and out of the page, or down here, it's free to move up and down. So what we can do is segment those DC electrodes, and that gives us a little bit more control of where it is in that direction. Let's see. And so with this, we can use the fabrication facilities at Sandia to make pretty complex devices. These are devices that are actually used in trapped ion labs around the world for lots of different applications, mostly quantum computing. But it gives us a lot of control over the ions. And having them be fabricated means they're pretty reliable and consistent in their operations. We can store ions for hours of time. The ions can move around. I think the little video was playing earlier. We can actually separate them and remerge them and stuff like that. For quantum computing, all of our ions are connected if they're in the same well because they'll feel each other wiggling around. We can do high fidelity operations. And for the atomic clocks, these are really small, which is great because if you can put something on a chip, that's something that you can, you know, feasibly say, all right, we could put that into a satellite. So that's the microfabricated traps. Now that we have a microfabricated thing, why not fold in other technologies into this as well? Like all of those lasers that were around the system, what if we can do the light delivery on chip instead of being external to the vacuum system? So the DARPA TICTAC project has done some of this where we actually have waveguide layers built into the chip and output couplers that kind of direct the beam in an angle to interact with an ion that sits above. So we've fabricated some of these. They're multi-layer devices. So they have metal layers for the electrodes that we need for all of the confinement. They also have silicon nitride waveguides built in. We can do alumina waveguides for UV light delivery. Right now we're doing primarily diffraction gratings for input and output, but you also have the capability of doing edge coupling, which is supposed to be more efficient. And we did add a little bonus aluminum reflector, because if you have a diffraction grating that's diffracting a beam out of the chip to interact with your ion, you're also going to have a minus one order that's just going back into the chip and is light lost. So wouldn't it be nice if we could add a reflector that sends that light up to the atom as well? And you can see that in the picture over here. We have results on this device published in a paper from 2021, but I can just briefly go through some of the stuff we did. So one of the main concerns we have is we spend a lot of time on these microfabricated devices trying to make sure that the laser beams that we're using never see the dielectric materials in the device because the dielectric materials tend to charge up with UV light. We are using UV light, and if our material charges up, because our ion is an ion, it will notice that, and that can cause some problems. One of those problems is heating rates. People have suspected that if you have exposed dielectrics, your ions could heat themselves out of the trap. So one of the experiments that we did was we loaded our ion. So we have a little loading hole, and our oven would be behind this loading hole, spewing atoms up. We catch one, which is what we call loading. And then we can use those little electrodes to shuttle it around the surface. So we can shuttle it directly over the output coupler, which would be a location where the dielectric is exposed. And we can measure how fast the ion heats at those different locations. And it turns out from the data that we got, it actually doesn't heat statistically anything, which is really good news. They led us to believe that, hey, we don't need any kind of shielding for these things, which would overly complicate the devices we're trying to make. Another thing we did was we do know that there will be some kind of frequency shifting from the light there. Even if it's not a heating problem, there will be some charge buildup. So we can measure that charge buildup. So, you know, you have, remember with the electrodes we have, we produce some kind of trap minimum. I like to just think of it as a bowl. And your ion is going to sit in the middle of the bowl. But this bowl is produced by electric fields. So if you suddenly have a bonus electric field or a stray electric field or something from the dielectric charging up, your bowl might shift a little in some way. And what that means is there will be a different frequency associated with this harmonic potential than there is with this kind of wonky harmonic-ish potential. So you can actually measure that because you can measure that that what we call secular frequency of our ion, how fast it sloshes around in there. So we did that. We measured the frequency of that sloshing versus the time as we are pulsing on this light like we would need to for a clock. And you can see there's definitely a shift. We start down here, 4.83 megahertz, and we end up here around 4.855 megahertz. But it stabilizes after some time. So it reaches some kind of steady state charging. And that steady state charging actually works out fine for our clock operation. It's not going to contribute so much that we have to worry about it. So that's also good news. So that's some of the work that we've done with waveguides. The next thing we wanted to do was try out some detectors. Like in that picture way back, there's a giant black box on top of the vacuum system. That's just for the camera to detect the light coming from the ions. What if we don't need all of that? What if we can integrate the detector into the chip? So we built some of these devices where one of the underlying layers is a single photon avalanche detector built into the device. And so our ion is pretty close to that. It's about 70 microns away from the surface of this device, which means we'll be able to collect a reasonable, you know, solid angle of photons emitted. So we can actually detect using those the signal from our ion. So with nothing else changing, having an ion there versus not having an ion there, which was pretty great because this was the first time anybody had used an integrated SPAD or single photon avalanche detector to in a functional ion trap. And bonus points, it was at room temperature, which is why there's so many dark counts. But there were some problems. And one of those problems that I'll point out here is in the plot up at the top there, where you can see how many counts we're detecting as we get closer and closer to directly over this, this detector. And if you look at that end, at the x-axis, it only goes to 80. So these detectors have to be biased with the voltage in order to operate. And remember, our ions are sensitive to charge, which means they're sensitive to voltage. So in fact, with these devices, anytime our SPAD fired, our ion would get kicked out of the trap. So we couldn't actually get them close enough to get the best efficiency that we wanted. And there's a publication on this stuff too. So the takeaway from those detector experiments and the waveguide experiments is that we don't need shielding for heating rate or for charge buildup, but we definitely need some kind of shielding if we want to be able to detect our ions. So the next thing that we worked on is trying to put all of these components into a single device, have waveguides, not just the silicon nitride, but also alumina, so that we can address all the wavelengths we need for our ions, and to have the detectors in the same device. And here in our plans, we had designed a way to add ITO coating. So indium tin oxide is a great shielder. It's transparent, so we could still get light through, but it acts as like a grounding layer, so our ion shouldn't see the voltage. Unfortunately, Sandia said, nope, you can't put ITO coatings on these. We won't do ITO coatings in our fabrication facility because we are specialized in rad hard devices for nuclear deterrence, and we're not gonna let your silly little ion trap mess up that process. So we need a backup plan, right? So here's our backup plan. If you look really closely to these images, these big holes, these are the openings, the cutouts for the detectors, and we put a mesh over them. So we basically made a little Faraday cage with one of our metal layers to try to shield it. And this was enough for us to actually be able to shuttle our ions over the detectors. The other thing that came out of this trap is we're actually able to use, instead of free space optics and just doing some tests with the waveguide delivered light, we're able to use entirely waveguide delivered light to trap our ions. So here you can see them with waveguide, and then this is free space light. So we have a similar signal in both of those two, which is great. So the next thing we thought about is, well, this is cool, but now that we have these tiny little things, why do we need that gigantic vacuum system? Couldn't we make that a little bit smaller? It kind of has to happen for it to go up in space. So there's a lot of work that's enabled by these microfabricated surface traps in making things smaller. So one of those things is there's a collaboration between Fulcana and Duke University that said, what if we just take those little tiny traps and we put a lid on it, and we put that lid on it inside of a larger vacuum system, and then we can pop it out and use it for whatever we want to do. And so they've done this sort of thing where they have a ring that would be added to like this outside metal edge of the ceramic pin grid array that these devices are on. So here's the ring here in gold. And then you can have a corresponding groove on the lid, and you can make a seal with that. And so these kinds of things are great in cryo systems because you don't need to have active pumping in a cryo system. You can get good enough vacuum alone, but you can also add a little vacuum pump, and Cold Quanta has done this as well, where they add a little ion pump on the side for room temperature systems. But the neat part about this is you're going from a giant thing on a table in a laboratory, like an 8x10 optics table, something like this. And it's so cute. And, you know, this is so far has been a clock talk, but when you start to think about using trapped ions for quantum computing or anything for quantum computing, you kind of want it to be a tiny little chip that you could imagine being in a computer. And that actually gets to that level for me conceptually, like, yes, that could be the processor of a computer. Okay, but all this stuff, like a lot of this vacuum size here is because of these windows. And remember, we're not using free space optics anymore. We're using waveguides integrated in our devices. And we don't need this giant window on top to detect photons for our camera because we're using integrated detectors. So do we even need all of this? Probably not. So the design that we've come up with at Sandia is something like this, where we would have our little tiny atom chip, which is here, and we have a lid that can go on the top to give us some optical access so we can see kind of what's going on. But down below, it's connected to the vacuum system, and it can be made very, very small. So here we would have edge coupling into those waveguides on the device. and we would have those integrated detectors and then, you know, an actual just general electronics chip for controlling all of the input and output signals that we need. So we fabricated some of these devices that would have that ring for bonding and also have all of the waveguides we need to create this clock with multiple atoms at different sites. And we started testing some of those efficiencies of the light going through those waveguides. So we have fun little pictures that look like this, showing that we can actually address all of the sites that we want to. Okay, so that's kind of where we're at with that project. Project ended, but there's a continue on project that's just starting up. So we'll kind of see where things go. And hopefully I've taught you a little bit about these different efforts going on at Sandia. Maybe you think they're cool, maybe not. Maybe I will further woo you by talking about Q-Scout, because I think I have, yes, I have a little bit of time. So another thing you can do with trapped ions is make quantum computers, as I mentioned early on. So at Sandia, we have something called the Quantum Scientific Computing Open User Testbed, or Q-Scout. So here, I'm showing slightly different energy. It's the same energy level diagram with different arrows. So we're still going to be Doppler cooling our ions. That step is always the same. The vacuum system, always the same. The oven, always the same. Doppler cooling. But now, instead of using a clock transition, we are going to use these states as our zero for a qubit and our one. And we need a way to go between zero and one. And we do that by, looks like one of my arrows isn't there. But we basically apply two different frequencies of this 355 nanometers that are separated by about 12.6 gigahertz because that's what this transition spacing is. And this does what we call a Raman transition. And allows us to control whether our qubit is a zero or a one. So the things you would need to make a quantum computer with trapped ions. So here we're using not just a single ion in a trap, we're using multiple ions in a trap, and each of those ions is a qubit. And so we need to be able to control whether that qubit is a zero or a one. And we need to be able to do that individually for each ion. We need to be able to measure if they're a zero or a one, also individually. We need to be able to do superposition states and also entanglement. And so with the Q-Scout system, we have a device which has what we call individual addressing beams. So that Raman laser, the 355 nanometer laser, we focus those down sub-micron beam waves. These ions are spaced about 4 or 5 microns, and we can individually address them. We're using a 32-channel AOM, and so we can, just by using electronics and frequencies, we can tune what beams are on and off. And then what we've done is we've aligned an imaging system to these ions such that the photons collected or emitted from those ions are focused onto individual cores of a multi-core fiber. And each of those cores goes to a single PMT. So we have individual readout of which state each of those ions are on. And because they're fiber coupled, we get really good detection error rates. It's very, very good. So the cool thing about Q-Scout, from my opinion, is that this is something that Sandia built and maintains, but it's really a user facility. So if any of you don't have a quantum computer in your garage, but you have a cool idea for an algorithm that you would like to run or a characterization kind of thing that you would like to do, you can write a short proposal to Q-Scout and submit it. And if it looks like something that we could actually do on our system, you can run it on our system. And we have some advantages over the commercial systems that are out there today. Like, you can log on right now to IBM and start using one of their computers. But what we do is we give you as much control as possible over everything, essentially. So you can control the phase, frequency, and amplitude of each of those individual beams in your code, which is something that is not readily available in a lot of the commercial systems out there. It's also free, so that's fun. Right now we're accepting proposals on a rolling basis, so you can just submit a white paper anytime. We have a website, pscout.sandia.gov for that. And if you want to know all the gory details about how to build a quantum computer, we have this paper out in IEEE Transactions on Quantum Engineering called Q-Scout Engineering, a Trapped-Ion Computer, or something like that. I forget the exact title. But we talk about, basically give a blueprint for how you could build your own quantum computer. Okay, so I think I'll wrap up so there's plenty of time for questions. I didn't include any slides on my outreach stuff, but if you have questions on that, I'm really happy to answer them too. And I just want to point out that, as I said in the beginning, this is really multidisciplinary at this point, this whole field. So we have a couple people that were listed on the title slide. Those were kind of the main contributors to the data in the TikTok project, but this is supported by an entire team of experimental trapped ion people. We have a whole team of fabrication engineers. We have a whole team of theory and software engineers. And then these are just general engineers, but a lot of photonics engineers and additional electronic engineers that have supported all of these projects. So we also have internships at Sandia for undergrads and grad students. They open up in the fall, so look early. And we have postdoc positions that are open like basically all the time. If you're interested in any of that, please feel free to reach out to me. And for faculty members, as you are largely left out of the open positions thing, we're starting to do joint faculty appointments between Sandia and universities. So that gives you the option of having kind of a dual role where you have access to resources at Sandia. So you can also talk to me about that if you're interested. And with that, I'll thank you and take questions.
Could you go back one slide here to your stuff? Maybe you said this, but do the ions need to be so cold with respect to their translation? They need to be in the ground quantum state, or
it's better if they're close. So we do something called sideband cooling, which gets them to a pretty low N bar, as we call it. The other cooling thing that I didn't talk about, which isn't necessarily related to the cooling of their internal state, but a cooling on a level that we can all understand better is, we have a room temperature system for Q-Scout, but we're also developing a cryo-based system. And the idea there is for the room temperature system, this is like our workhorse, we're running code with up to 5 ions right now, but we wanna do longer chains of ions, so more qubits for our users. And as you build up the number of qubits, the number of ions in that chain, you're more likely to lose them from collisions with atmospheric gases, even though it's in a vacuum system. But if you go into cryo, you can cool out a lot of those gases and improve the lifetimes of your chains. So that's the other thing that we're working on temperature-wise. Yeah, of course. Next.
Thank you for the talk. I wanted to ask how many, when you're talking about sort of your on-device cooling or vacuum, I don't remember exactly specifically, but
the little tiny thing?
Yeah, that you could attach to the top.
I was like, I know this much.
Yeah. I was wondering, you were showing it for the clocks we were doing one specific trap on. Does that expand nicely for, like, say, a system like this? If you were trying to grab multiple ions, would you still be able to use that same device, or would it like run out? Would it be limited by the size?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, first caveat is that for the clock, we're actually using more than one ion. And the reason is, but they're not in the same well in the device. And the reason is that we can be doing actual clock measurements on one ion while measuring systematic effects on another one and feeding that back into the system. So we can kind of be coordinating those things all at once. So this is actually a multi-ion ensemble clock. The second question though about like the size, let me get my mouse over to this. I don't actually know where it thinks one screen is with respect to the other, which is why I'll just push the buttons. this device. So we actually have one of these in our cryo system that we're doing for QScout. So we have basically this exact thing. As you can see in this picture, I think this picture has, I don't know how many, let's estimate 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. How many?
42.
42, excellent. So you can trap a large number of ions, and I think folks have trapped up to 100 in these, what we call high optical access traps. So we're not running out of space yet with these devices, but there's a lot of people thinking about how to scale up as you want to get more and more qubits. One of the advantages of the atomic physics platforms is that we think maybe in some ways we can scale up better than other systems, but that's kind of yet to be seen.
Could you comment a little bit about what you said at the beginning about semiconductor materials?
Yeah, I don't know a lot about that, except that I know that people are looking at spin qubits in semiconductor devices. So basically the spin of a single electron in a well. And at Sandia, there's some work being done. They do publish, so you can find publications on that sort of thing. So at the Sandia effort, I know there are groups around the world who are doing that. I think QDelph was one place that was really involved in that. But yeah, they're basically using the spin of the electron as their zero and one state. Yeah, I'm doing very similar thing.
So it's kind of ferromagnetic materials?
I think you can choose a variety of materials. And I'm sorry, I don't know many details about that. I'd be happy to put you in touch with some people and or send you some papers and references. Yeah, sure.
So when I mentioned this for anybody, efficiency of this one compared to you describe a reason of efficiency. What efficiency you made the efficiency of these
efficiency.
Right. Okay. 15,000 years in this
in Michigan. Like how many seconds they move, how stable they are. We have not. We just haven't put all the pieces together to actually make a clock. That was the goal. We didn't quite get there. So what we did was focus on demonstrating the individual technology pieces. Because there's actually some stuff that we at Sandia didn't even work on. There were other components of the project. And so in the continuation, we're hoping to have the opportunity to kind of pull these things together and actually make a block and see how it performs. Yeah.
I was wondering if you recently had any undergraduates participating in any kind of internships or anything like that, was strictly graduate?
No, we do. We definitely do undergrad. So last year, I don't think we had any track ion groups last year that I'm aware of. We definitely have a lot throughout the broader quantum program at Sandia. This year, I think we're going to have at least 3 undergraduate interns just in the track ion group at Sandia. And I think the list is somewhere around 50 for overall quantum interns. But those that 50 also includes grad. Yeah.
Also, do you know what fields more or less they typically come from? Are they all physicists or are they all like engineers?
A lot of physics, but also a lot of engineering, software engineering, because we do have a full software team. We have students who come from engineering backgrounds. So we have mechanical engineers that participate in our weekly group meetings to design various things like aligning those submicron focus beams to our ions and also aligning the cores of that multi-core fiber for the PMTs, like that, and doing that inside of a cryo system is a little bit tricky. So we work with the mechanical team to design the flexure stage that does the alignment of those focusing lenses for the individual addressing beams.
And then also to make sure that all of the pieces of the other optical systems work around the cryostat. So lots of, and then kind of the fabrication team is a little bit outside of the track ion team, but there's a lot of internship opportunities. And it's one of our main ways of recruiting students, which is a challenge for us. So yeah, we love interns. Is there anyone here? Too late this year, next week.
Yeah. Question on the fidelity of like the single qubit and double qubit.
Oh yeah.
Is it, if you have to do like multiple gates to a qubit, is the fidelity, is it multiplicative, additive, or is it just a standard like 99.5?
So good. I think it kind of depends on whether you're doing those gates simultaneously on different qubits or if you're following them on. We do know that we can do roughly 15 entangling gates on a pair of ions before they decohere into a useless state. So that's kind of the limit that we're at with that. Yeah.
Well, yes, so decoupling gears would be before I can look to this by but
never. Well, I don't think that's what, like, you know, you can think about it as like, do you have a server or a supercomputer in your house?
Right.
You're probably not gonna go to Best Buy and buy one of those. Those have been around for a while. So
okay, so you have to connect to work.
Yeah, but you also don't need a quantum computer in your life, like, you know, the body's pretty complicated, so maybe our smart devices would, but you know, you're trying to solve very particular problems with a quantum computer at this point. You're not going to be playing video games on a quantum computer, that sort of thing. So if you're very particular set problems, don't believe the hype. What's that?
So you'd be more powerful.
Yeah, exactly.
Great. Is there no more questions? I think Megan again.
I think you really like the hike, and then you want to come back every other month.
Perfect. Yeah, I can do a Q Scout talk next time and dive into that a little bit.